formal, something a little more, well, we can do background stuff with it. We hope eventually we'll be able to provide perhaps compilations and articles that would relate to a particular Deepen web video program. And we're hoping to put all this material up on our website with the video itself, of course, on our YouTube channel. And we hope that we'll be able to provide people with quite a wide range of choices for information about the faith this way. You'll notice that we're being broadcast live on our Facebook page and also on our YouTube channel. You can see the addresses of those down below. They're very simple and easy to remember, fortunately. So if you get thrown out, or if you have any friends who are trying to get in, but be sure to let them know. This is a free service of the Wilmette Institute, and so I have our address to which checks need to be written. If anybody's interested in making a contribution, we certainly would appreciate that. They would just be sent to the National Baha'i Center. Of course, only Baha'is can contribute to the programs of this sort. Today, we have a marvelous opportunity to hear Kevin Locke, a Lakota artist, with whom I think many of you are familiar, speaking about fasting from an Indigenous perspective. And I don't really want to give a long introduction because we're trying to focus really on the people who are going to be speaking, so that will be it. We'll turn the screen over to Kevin now, and we will see his screen and him, and Kevin, you can take it away.
Okay, thank you, Rob, and I'd like to say good afternoon to everybody. I think this is the fourth day of the fast, and I really appreciate this opportunity to visit with you all about something really near and dear to all of us. And I'm here at my little house on the prairie in Wakbala, South Dakota. This is one of the eight districts on Standing Rock, and Standing Rock has recently achieved a worldwide notoriety because of the stand that the people here took to protect the resource, the Missouri River resource. And it's really an interesting stand because of the fact that this is one of the poorest parts of the United States. Every census, they always rank the counties by economic indicators, and this region right here is the largest concentration of the poorest counties in the nation. And so we have about 80% unemployment here. And so it's interesting how a little group of people like this decided they wanted to block, you know, the largest oil conglomerate in the world, or one of the largest, and pretty much stood their ground until really the full force, military force, was brought to bear, which consisted of hundreds of millions of dollars. I don't want to get political, but it's just such an interesting scenario that played out right here. And it's just miraculous how on the first day of the Baha'i Fast, we have a document from the World Center, from the Universal House of Justice, that just underscores all these points. And it's really just such a great feast, such a banquet for thought and meditation that we can implement now in our everyday life. And as you know, that the document was addressed to the individual Baha'is throughout the world, although, of course, it has implications for communities and institutions. But it's such wonderful foundational guidance for us. And before we go really too far, I thought it would be really good. I'd like to offer a prayer, and I'd like to offer one of the prayers of Baha'u'llah, and for the fast, revealed for the fast. And also, I'd like to sing one of the fasting songs that we have here, and we can maybe touch on that later. But as you all know, fasting is a universal spiritual mandate, and really throughout the world, all the different revealed faith traditions have a provision analogous to the fast, whether it's Lent or Ramadan or Yom Kippur or Dream Time in Australia. And of course, throughout North America, this has been the foundational spiritual practice for tens of thousands of years. And so within that tradition, I'll offer a song. And this song, I'll try to translate it from the original Dakota language. It starts out, it's like a conversation. So the first part is this voice from the heavenly realms calling down and speaking to the person that's fasting. And it says, look heavenward. And I am well pleased that you are observing this divine commandment, in other words, fasting. And as the sun moves over the heavens, this is, now they didn't have clocks a long time ago, so the voice is saying, as the sun moves over the heavens, this a sacred relationship, a sacred pact you are making. And then the next part of the song, same melody, but it switches and it goes from the person observing the law of fasting is calling out to the heavens, asking that this sacrifice or the fast that the person has pledged be recognized. And then the person testifies next that saying that everything holy upon the earth you have given, and that through this, through all the things upon the earth, you manifest yourself. Hokshila wa mayankayo, Hokshila wa mayankayo, Mioch awakanchaya, Kaya kuchi te, I am pewe. Praise be to thee, O Lord my God. I beseech thee by this revelation, whereby darkness hath been turned into light, through which the frequented fane hath been built, and the written tablet revealed, and the outspread roll uncovered, to send down upon me and upon them who are in my company that which will enable us to soar into the heavens of thy transcendent glory, and will wash us from the stain of such doubts as have hindered the suspicious from entering into the tabernacle of thy unity. I am the one, O my Lord, who hath held fast the cord of thy loving kindness and clung to the hem of thy mercy and favors. Do thou ordain for me and for my loved ones the good of this world and of the world to come. Supply them, then, with the hidden gift thou didst ordain for the choicest among thy creatures. These are, O my Lord, the days in which thou hast bidden thy servants to observe the fast. Blessed is he that observeth the fast wholly for thy sake and with absolute detachment from all things except thee. Assist me and assist them, O my Lord, to obey thee and to keep thy precepts. Thou verily hast power to do what thou choosest. There is no God but thee, the all-knowing, the all-wise. All praise be to God, the Lord of all worlds. And I would like to share with you a little story of my own introduction to the traditional or indigenous North American law of fasting. And for this this area in the Dakotas, the symbol or the physical token or manifestation, the symbol of the covenant is the pipe. And so if you look at any picture of people from the 19th century, like here's a photograph of Sitting Bull, and you can see, you look at those pictures and you see almost every one of them, they're holding a pipe. So it's right down here. He's got it with it in his left hand, and it's resting on his right hand. And I didn't show it. Okay, sorry. Okay. Can you see it yet? Oh, okay. You have to make a little disclaimer. This is the first time I've done this. I'm really technologically challenged here. Thank you. But anyway, this is the photograph, and it's just typical of the photographs you see of the people from the 19th century. They're always make sure that they are photographed holding their pipe. And of course, like I said, this is the emblem or the token of the covenant, the law of God. And so I just wanted to share that with you. So then in my own family, I have a pipe, and my grandfather even went so far as to he wrote down the line of succession, so that my grandfather lists himself as the seventh one in line, genealogical line, to have that pipe. And he wrote this, I think, in 1930s or something, this little document here. And then it went to my mom, and it went to me, so that's the ninth. I'd be the ninth one to have that pipe. Probably almost identical to the one that Sitting Bull has right here. And so then when my mom gave that to me, I was about 17 or 18, she just decided that I should take over, and then I really didn't know what to do, so then I asked different people around the community here in Wakapala, and the response that they all gave me is they just pointed out this way, and if you look out this way, it's there's no stoplights between here and Billings. That's about 400 miles, I think. There's no stoplights, so in other words, if my dog runs away, I can see him running away for about 3 or 4 days from here. And so that's what whenever I asked about how do I find out about this pipe, then they always point that way. Well, you got to go out there. So what they're referring to is what they mean is that you got to go out in the wilderness and fast. And this is the timeless tradition here in North America, is to go out fasting. And so then the big problem is that starting in the late 1800s, you know, all those traditional practices were outlawed by government edicts. So then the result is that for the most part, a lot of it died out, and there were just very few places or people who maintain a link to that covenant, to that traditional covenant. And so I did find elders that could help me. And so then starting in about, 45 years ago or so, I started going out fasting every year, and I didn't feel satisfied with the result. You know, I'd go out like 2 days, 3 days, 4 days. Of course, you go out in the wilderness out here. It's a prairie wilderness. Go out on a lonely hill, and it could be cold. It could be freezing at night. It could be 110 degrees or more during the day. You don't know the conditions, but yet you stand out there because this is the tradition. It's a very rigorous tradition and it's could be life-threatening. It's really more of an ordeal than anything else, and you can see how this manifestation of this law of fasting really reflects the lifestyle of the people out here who do really traditionally, even up today, lead very Spartan life, very rigorous lifestyle, the subsistence lifestyle. But anyway, this is what I did for many years, and then concurrent with that, I met some friends. They're both from the husband and wife who were home front pioneering here. They're both from North Dakota. The husband, Jerry Hendrickson, is from Catherine, North Dakota, which is south of Valley City, and then his wife, Diane, is from Beach, which is over on the west side. And I think they're both full-blooded Norwegian. So that my spiritual genealogy is pure Norwegian on all sides for me. But anyway, they pioneered here, so I heard about the Baha'i faith through them. So I was very intent on learning, and then this kind of like at the same time as that, I was still pursuing my the spiritual quest, and so then finally my uncle who was helping me. I told him, I says, I've been doing this fasting every year, and I don't feel like I really achieved my goals, what I wanted, which was really, self-discovery and just to find a path in life. Well, then he said, well, what you really have to do, he says, you have to focus because you're too scattered. Your prayers and your mind is just all over. So you have to narrow that down and just focus it down to a pinpoint. And then you have to concentrate your prayers on that goal, and then you'll achieve what you want. And so then I started my little study. This was like a year out from my target date. And I think that was like the fifth or sixth time I went out fasting. And I started listening to different elders when they pray, and I noticed a recurrent theme. And the theme was that I'd hear the elders, people when they talk, they say wakantanka tunkashila niishta wakau kuta makata awan yechigala kapie na lila nitaku jakpaku lila stustel kakish ichapi uchake lila chanku woshkishke oganam kiayapi na lila oyokpaza Uhunkes a se ununipi. Onaha nitrawo konze ogna. Tokata nitrawo ita na chankuwaste na luta na chankuwa ka makata egana kinkta naha. Dokel uyeunkia pita chanke uyechipazo pita. In other words, I'll say it in English. I hear people praying this way. They pray, Grandfather above. Our Heavenly Grandfather above, look down and behold your grandchildren, referring to us, people who live on the earth, human beings, and you see how we suffer. You see how you see what the darkness that surrounds us. You see that every day is worse than the day before, and we're just blind and lost in this life. And yet, you have promised that you would put a light down in this world, and you would show us through this light a beautiful road, and this road would be good, and this road would be holy and red, and this road would be straight, and that you would guide us and lead us upon this road, mark it out, and reveal your grace through this journey on this red road. You always hear about the red road, Chankuluta. And so then I thought, that's what I'm going to pray for. I want to pray for to find this road. And so then that's what I did. I was just praying and praying. And that particular year I was out fasting. It's not too far. It's within 10 miles of where I'm sitting here. It's a high promontory. And they call it, nowadays they call it Rattlesnake Butte because it's infested with rattlesnake dens. But in pre-reservation days, they call that Wambali Oyuspa Paha. They call it Catch Eagle Butte because that's what people would fast and they would catch eagles on that hill, on that butte. Anyway, the time that I chose to go there every day was over 110 degrees. So I was up there 4 days, and I thought I was just going to die, and I thought, it's okay. It's okay, because this life that I have is just so meaningless, so purposeless, and if that's the will of God, it's, so be it. But it just, that heat, you know, like with no food, no water, day after day, relentless pounding heat, then I thought, well, that's it for me. And then when I got done with the pledge I made for those 4 days and four nights of fasting, then I felt so downcast, so dispirited. And it was in the midst of this that my Baha'i friends came to visit. And they said, Kevin, you know, you've been learning about the Baha'i faith for some time now, and you know about Baha'u'llah, you know about Abdul Baha, you know about the Bab, you know about the laws. And I said, yes, yes. They said, well, you should become a Baha'i. I said, yes, I should. I said, well, how do you do that? They said, well, you just have to sign this declaration card. And so then I said, well, if I sign this declaration card, I said, what does that do? They said, well, it's just, all it really means is you just identify yourself as a Baha'i. You just, when you sign down here at the bottom, it just means you identify yourself with the Baha'i community, they said. I said, oh, you mean there's a community? They said, yeah, see, at that time, I think the closest Baha'i community was probably Minneapolis. That's 400 miles east, or maybe Denver. That's 650 miles south, or maybe Regina or Winnipeg. That's about 300-400 miles north. So they said, yeah, there's Baha'is everywhere, just not here. I said, okay, that's good. I said, I'd like to do that. I'd like to become a Baha'i. But then they said, well, I said, if I do this, I want to find out something. And I said, well, do Baha'is have prayers? He says, oh, yeah, we forgot to give you a prayer book. So they gave me the prayer book, and so then I grabbed hold of this prayer book, and I just opened it up, and I turned, just quite coincidentally, I turned to the prayer in the Tablets of Divine Plan revealed for the Central States, for this area right here. And I just turned and I started to read that. It says, O Lord my God, praise and thanksgiving be unto thee, for thou hast guided me to the highway of the kingdom, suffered me to walk in the straight and far-stretching path, illumined my eye by beholding the splendors of thy light. Anyway, the whole prayer, but what really grabbed me was that the very first line, that was the answer to my prayer, what I've been suffering and darn near died for, that praise and thanksgiving be unto thee, for thou hast guided me to the highway of the kingdom, suffered me to walk in the straight and far-stretching path. And it just hit me like a ton of bricks or something, a reality pie in the face, that's what I was praying for, exactly what I was praying for. And I'd like to say that this law of fasting, I think from an indigenous perspective, is such a great blessing. And even before I was a Baha'i, before the incident I mentioned, I think for 1 or 2 years, maybe 2 years before actually declaring, I participated in the Baha'i fast because I just love the idea so much. It's so attractive. You know, there are exemptions, you know, for, you know, of course, women in different stages, and of course for, you know, the travelers, for the people engaged in strenuous physical labor, there's the exemptions for people that are sick and so on and so forth. So it's really a very, very lenient law, but then it makes this law of fasting so accessible to all people. So it's really one of the greatest blessings, the Baha'i law of fasting. And I really love it so much. And you know, with the indigenous style of fasting observed throughout North America, and everywhere you go, it's quite different. I know out here in the prairies, they'll go to a mountaintop or a hilltop. I know, for instance, the Blackfeet out there in Montana and Alberta, they've got this particular mountain they go to. They call it Chief Mountain. I think it's actually on the Alberta side. I know that the Cheyenne, especially the Cheyenne, go to go down here to Bear Butte. That's their like their Mecca. So everywhere, there's every place you go, they have their particular fasting sites. And I'll mention that it's extremely rigorous, and people will prepare for a year in advance. And of course, you have to be in excellent health to be able to participate in it. But you have to remember that that law is from a time before people had processed foods and had all kinds of sugar and things like this. They just ate pure food, and they lead a lifestyle that creates a lot of physical strength and stamina. And one thing I'll mention about fasting, I'm not sure how many people know this, but you only experience hunger within the first 24 hours of your fast. And I think physiological hunger, physiologically speaking, hunger occurs because of the digestive system sending impulses or messages to the brain that it's time for the for food to be starting to happen in the digestive tract. So then that is the physical sensation of hunger that we experience. And of course, you know, the blood sugar and everything, but after 24 hours, all that switches off. So then you actually don't have the sensation of hunger. It totally disappears. And then it's, but the thirst is always there. But it's all that is replaced by this really overwhelming feeling. Now, I'm not telling people to go out and fast for 2, 3, 4 days. I'm not saying that, but I'm just saying this is what happens. And what occurs is this incredible connection, so that everything in creation takes on a heightened significance. So you look out, when you look outside, and you see like just the movement of the wind in the branches. There's no leaves out yet, but just the movement of the wind in the branches, and the way that the shadow is cast, and the way the movement is occurring, all that takes on heightened meaning. Even like the clouds, the shape of the clouds, the direction of the clouds, all those shapes, the birds, every little detail of creation just begins to pop out. It just explodes into significance. And really, it's through the law of fasting and through this this mental discipline that, just like the song that I mentioned at first about the sacredness of creation, it begins to really stand out. And so this is why I always say this law of fasting is so foundational here in North America, because it's through this law of fasting that, and as the song did say this also, I didn't translate it fully into English, but all these gifts of creation are revealed to mankind. The gifts of the medicines, the different techniques for subsistence, the insights, spiritual insights, the songs, the culture itself, civilization itself, is really fueled and grows, is nurtured through this law of fasting. And so it's so easy to see how, you know, when we look at in that context, we look at these Baha'i quotes, and this take on so much significance from an indigenous North American perspective when we look at them. Just like here, I'll just briefly go through it. So, fasting and obligatory prayer are as two wings to man's life. Blessed be the one who soareth with their aid in the heaven of the love of God, the Lord of all worlds. So really, when you think about it, I think especially at this time of the day, during the Baha'i fast, you can begin to feel that, just like you start to gain a little bit of a trajectory and lift, and that's begin to really soar. And especially, it's so wonderful to read some of these prayers. A lot of the prayers that you see in prayers and meditations of Baha'u'llah, some of those, you know, are like 15, 20 pages in length. And then that's when you really want to get in there and start to read those prayers. I know a lot of you are like that as well. It says, verily the religion of God is likened to heaven. Fasting is its sun and obligatory is its moon. In truth, they are the pillars of religion, whereby the righteous are distinguished from those who transgress his commandments. So I know there's that similar quote. It says, in the heaven of the religion of God, two shining orbs have been ordained, fasting and prayer. Fasting is the sun and prayer is the moon thereof. So the analogy here is that is religion is like heaven. So when you look out and into the world, you see, into the heavens, you see there's basically two shiny things out there, the sun and the moon. So then in that other quote, this quote, it says, fasting is the sun and obligatory prayer is the moon. But you think of the relative relationship of the sun and the moon, of course, the moon is very much subsidiary to the sun. And that's the analogy that we have with fasting is the sun. So we can see the significance of the law of fasting here. Let's see, another one. Verily, I say, fasting is the supreme remedy and the most great healing for the disease of self and passion. And now we can see how in the world at large, you know, there's so much spiritual disease in the world at large. And I wanted to particularly highlight this quote here. Yes. These are, oh my God, the days whereon thou didst enjoin thy servants to observe the fast. With it, thou didst adorn the preamble of the book of thy laws revealed unto thy creatures, and didst deck forth the repository of thy commandments in the sight of all who are in thy heaven and all who are on thy earth. Thou hast endowed every hour of these days with a special virtue inscrutable to all except thee, whose knowledge embraceth all created things. Thou hast also assigned unto every soul a portion of this virtue in accordance with the tablet of thy decree and the scriptures of thine irrevocable judgment. Every leaf of these books and scriptures thou hast moreover allotted to each one of the peoples and kindreds of the earth. So I love this quote because it talks about here every hour of these days endowed with a special virtue. And from an indigenous perspective, so many of the songs, when I first started going out fasting, my uncle, he asked me, he says, if I help you, if I put you out fasting, what are you going to do out there in the wilderness fasting? I said, well, I'm just going to pray. He says, well, what are you going to pray about? I said, well, I'm just going to pray about my problems and my family, and I want guidance. And then he says, how are you going to pray? I said, well, I'm just going to voice my prayer. Then he said, he's talking about this collective, the Lakota people. He says, when we pray, he's talking about the traditional laws. When we pray, he says, we sing our prayers. And then he says, well, what are you going to sing if I help you? Then I couldn't answer him. Then next thing he said, well, if you're just going to be out there singing like row, row, row your boat or Mary Had a Little Lamb, I can't help you. And so, see, that was where he ended the conversation. So what he wanted from me, then my response, I have to pledge or I have to dedicate myself to learning his ways. And in the I'm sure it's the same with all the indigenous people of North America. In the Lakota way, this law of fasting is so important that there's a huge corpus of songs that accompany this, that outline all the different laws and features of this divine provision or the law of fasting. And so what he wanted me to do was to commit myself to learning those songs. And so that's what I endeavored to do. And to this day, I think I can still recall most of them. But getting back to this, so many of the songs, they talk about the like it would be analogous to every hour of these days. But they don't use the clock. See, in these songs, they don't use the clock. What they use is the movement of the sun and the moon and the morning star and the other constellations that the people use to discern time and place in the universe. So these songs are about that, but they all talk about the sacredness of this time. How when the moment you participate in this law of fasting, you step into a whole new world, a whole new realm, which is so close to the heaven, so close to God, and this is where you enter. And then so in this, but Baha'u'llah gives us so much more information about this sacred time here. He says that, so he accentuates the fact that every hour of these days of the fast is endowed with a special virtue, which is inscrutable to all save God. And then this is the part that I don't think anybody knew ahead of time in the previous dispensations, and that every soul has been assigned a portion of this virtue. And I think about that, you know, like here in Wakpala, I can the road, Highway 1806, is about 100 yards from here. So I can look out my little window here and I can see the cars. I can actually look down, I can see them coming from a mile away. So if I use my binoculars, I can actually see that car, and then I know from a mile away who everybody is. And you know exactly where they're going. You know if they're going to the post office, if they're going to the store, or wherever, whichever direction they're going. There's one road here. And so then it makes me, then I think about that, I says, wow, every one of, you know, the people here, and every one of us, everybody, has been assigned of this, a portion of this virtue, this divine virtue. And the way I begin to think about it is that this law of fasting, you know, mankind has somewhat strayed from this, because, you know, how I don't really know people that much that participate in Lent, you know, in Christianity. Sometimes people say, oh yeah, for Lent I'm giving up chocolate on Friday or something like this. And I said, wow, that's probably really big for some people, but here in the Baha'i faith, it's really substantial. It's so beautiful. It's significant. The I don't want to belabor this, but it's just like this law of fasting has really eluded mankind. But now, to me, it's just like all this grace, all this virtue that's been assigned to all every soul on earth is just all pent up. It's like this huge reservoir of grace and bounty and blessing just pent up. And that when mankind discovers this revelation and these laws and how accessible it is, this reservoir, this ocean of bounty is just going to sweep over mankind and in this day. And and so much of it is pent up in this law of fasting that just a relative handful of people on earth now are observing. But when this becomes generalized, and then in this particular quote, again, not to belabor it too much, but it says, you see in there it says, every soul has been assigned a portion of this virtue, and this is in accordance with the tablet of thy decree and the scriptures of thine irrevocable judgment. So that's all in accordance with these scriptures. And now, the next to last sentence in this paragraph. So, every leaf of these books and scriptures thus, moreover allotted to each one of the peoples and kindreds of the earth. So like this big, you can look at it as a big book, and that every leaf in that book has been assigned to all the different kindreds. Just like in the Baha'i World Congress in 92, they had the roll call of the nations. And there's something like over 7,000 different kindreds. So it's a big, thick book. And if any of you have been to on pilgrimage, you'll see that one of the last projects of the Guardian was to really enumerate and to identify all the diverse kindreds who had enlisted under the under the banner of Baha'u'llah, and how much weight he had accorded that, or how much significance he had placed upon reaching all these diverse kindreds. And then when it takes on heightened meaning here when you think about how each kindred has been assigned, allotted, a leaf of these books. So we're really living in these exciting times now when all these different diverse kindreds are and regions of the world are opened up. And now, of course, the Baha'i world is developing those human resources to do that. Like out here in the prairies, you know, we have so many kindreds that are very geographically isolated, as it is all over the world. And so this has always been problematic, is, you know, how can we find human resources that can reach these isolated areas? And I think the clock is ticking. The clock is ticking because we have all these incredible ancestral knowledge and wisdom, and it's the only reason why it's being swept aside is because of the forces of materialism. We have forces of acculturation that are encroaching upon all this. Just like a few weeks ago, just to give an example of this, a few weeks ago we lost an elder. His name was Edwin Benson. And he was the very last native, fluent native speaker of Mandan. Mandan, at one time, they were a huge kindred right in this area. And when Lewis and Clark came up here in 1803, the Mandan were so wealthy. They had such refined and highly developed horticultural practices that they were able to host Lewis and Clark, I think, for two winters and provide for all their needs in this environment where it goes down to 40, 50 below without the wind chill. And so the Mandan, you know, they're noted historically for this and also developing all of these, you know, like corn, beans, squash, all these agricultural products that thrive on a short growing season, again, all through divine knowledge, through the gift of fasting. And so then I remember myself, you know, my uncle's adopted brother was a Mandan, Mr. Ralph Little Owl. He stayed with us. And I remember every day he would pray in Mandan. He'd always pray. We'd hear him. And I remember my neighbors would Mandans. Yeah. So now, it's really sad to think that I'm not going to hear that language anymore with that last speaker passing away. But this is happening all over the world. We're losing this huge resource of human knowledge. It's happening very fast, along with the whole environment. And I think, again, this we study this Universal House of Justice message, it's going to really heighten our understanding of that. I know that I'm running out of time here, but I just wanted to especially highlight that quote. And another one I'll mention here, which is really interesting too, is in terms of an indigenous perspective on the law of fasting. And this is from Gleanings, page 144, where Baha'u'llah says, speaking of God, he says, unto the cities of all nations, he hath sent his messengers, whom he hath commissioned to announce unto men tidings of the paradise of his good pleasure, and to draw them nigh unto the haven of abiding security, the seat of eternal holiness, and transcendent glory. Now, just as a commentary, we know that the universal manifestations of God have ever arisen and cast their light from that region of the world we identify as the Holy Land. But clearly we can see here from this quote, the way I see it, the way I understand it, is that no kindred or no segment of mankind has been deprived of this process of divine revelation. Well, they may not be universal manifestations of God, but holy souls, or luminaries, or divine beings who have appeared to with the same commission, which is to announce and invite mankind to this paradise, to draw them nigh into this haven of abiding security. And so the legacy of this in North America is so rich, it's so unbelievably rich, and I think it's pretty much under the radar, from what I understand, of the average resident of North America who's pretty much oblivious to it and unaware of the fact that really all the indigenous kindreds throughout the North America, throughout the world, really have been recipients of this divine bestowal. And each one of these luminaries has reinforced the law of fasting. Like here in this area, we have the maid of heaven, the angel Laskawi, who brought, and it's the legacy is very well known, the narrative of her appearance and her details of her teachings, and this was pretty much encapsulated and placed within the context of songs. So it's through songs, the original songs that she brought, that the details of the covenant are elucidated. But Rob, I think we came now to 2:49 Central Time, and I didn't get through my slides, but it's okay. I wanted to. This is kind of a. I kind of have a funny slide here that I'll put in here. This is from Sitting Bull. He says, "Wambuliki kahi umpiteshnehecha." So in other words, when they told Kakankiotake, Sitting Bull, and they told him that he had to give up his birthright, his covenant, his heritage, they told him he had to acculturate, and then his only response was, "It is not necessary for eagles to be crows or to become crows." So I put it in Lakota here. So he's saying that, in other words, like our station, our birthright is to soar, just like in the fasting quotes here, is our birthright is to soar. And of course, in this case, the eagle is emblematic or symbolic of the ascendant nature of the human spirit, which is what the law of fasting really empowers and jump starts and creates the momentum for. So that's our reality. That is our true station. So we don't have to descend from that station. That's what Sitting Bull is saying. We should just stay in that, keep our ascendant birthright. We don't have to lower ourselves to become, you know, like the crow is not a bad thing, but the crow, they just hop along the side of the road and they just look for, you know, roadkill. So we don't have to do that unless we really want to. So I think with that, Rob, should we go to the... is there questions?
We've got some questions. Thank you so much, Kevin. This was fascinating, and I very much appreciate seeing Sitting Bull as well as hearing his words.
Yeah. Well, that's a minor quote, but I just thought it was. I just wanted to say that because you know, one of the things that they talk about so much is, that, especially with this, you know, with the whole movement of protecting the waters, they call it decolonization. And then so people will say, well, how do you say decolonize in Lakota? Well, it's really easy. You say Kilakota. Kilakota, because this word Lakota, this is what the Maid of Heaven named the people when she adjured them or invited them to this paradise, which is to really invited the people to comply with the divine will, the divine standard. And in other words, she invited them to become human beings, truly human beings, and that's where she gave them the name Lakota. Lakota, which means to abide with the sacred law. Just like we know this, the world is a physical manifestation of a spiritual reality, so there's not different creations, separate creations, but all the handiwork of one divine will, one divine hand. And so then everything in the world is a counterpart to something in the spiritual world. So then we look at the mountain. We don't worship the mountain, but the mountain represents divine qualities and so forth. So in other words, this divine order is what she invited us into. And so this is what this is how you say decolonize. It means you go back. Kilakota means you go back to becoming a human being. You restore that nobility, that innate, that inherent nobility that we all have. And so that's the only way you can say decolonize is you don't have to deconstruct anything. We just go back to your birthright, return to
better. That's better than a translation. That's better than a translation.
That's better than decolonize, yeah.
a translation would be really quite culturally not quite right, you know?
That's right.
Yeah. We have several questions. Thank you very much for this fascinating presentation, and we've had lots and lots of people tuning in on Facebook as well as here on GoToWebinar. Janine asks this very interesting question. In the Baha'i faith, traditionally we observe the fast during the month of Allah. What traditionally has impelled indigenous folks, in your experience, to fast? Would it be a time of the year, a personal circumstance, desires and hopes for outcomes? Please share your thoughts. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a great question. It's I think that the law of fasting was pretty much ubiquitous, and it was also just like in the Baha'i faith, it's almost like a coming of age, so that when you reach the age of 15, you reach the age of spiritual maturity. And by the way, three of my grandkids are fasting with me too, so it's really wonderful. It's a great thing to see my little granddaughter. She just turned 15, and she gets up with me every morning, and we eat and we pray together and everything. So it's great. So it's in that sense, it's really exercising that free will that we have, that spiritual maturity that we have. And so then I think in that sense it's very, very parallel. And then just like you say, in the Baha'i faith we have the month of Allah, which is preceded by Ayami intercalary days, and it's like the transition, it's preparing for the spring. And it's exactly analogous to the traditional law of fasting that we have here, you know, the one pre-Christian, I would say, or pre-reservation law of fasting, which they start up when the thunders come back. So it's about now. It's usually March. And in fact, you know, like a part of this decolonization process is that they started this up years ago. They have a big pilgrimage in all the schools they let out around here, and they bust the kids down to the Black Hills. And they go to this place. It's been known for years and years as Harney Peak, but then they change it because Harney was he was a big General Harney was a big Indian killer. But we call it in Lakota we call it Hihankahapaha, which means the Owlmaker Mountain, Owlmaker Hill. See, the Owlmaker was it's kind of a mythical being who guards the spirit road, which is the Milky Way. So when a soul dies, they go on that journey, and then right straight above, you can see it if you don't have light pollution. But there's the Milky Way constellation forks. The main road goes off straight, and then there's a smaller road that tapers off to nothing. And there's a bright star in the middle. That's Hihankaha, and so Hihankaha guards that. And then when a soul approaches, then he asks your name, you state your name, and then your spiritual reality becomes manifest upon your being. And then so Hihankaha will look at that, and depending on what that Hihankaha determines, leave a step aside and allow you to go straight on that road throughout eternity, or it'll block the road, in which case you have to go on that other road, which kind of peters out to nothing. So then this is why they always say that we have this great relationship with our departed loved ones, so we pray for them and to get back on that road. But when the young people throughout this region, they go, they make a pilgrimage. It's the highest point between the Rockies and the Swiss Alps, and they'll go up there. They'll go up in a few weeks, and I don't know, probably hundreds or maybe thousands of kids go there, and they go there because it marks the beginning of this season of fasting, and it marks the time when we can really pray on behalf of all of creation and invoke that sacred covenant and pray for all of our departed relatives and just make that sacrifice, make that pilgrimage. And from that point, you can see into Montana, North Dakota, Wyoming, and you see practically all the way to the Missouri River. It's such a high promontory point. Anyway, that's I kind of got off track, but to answer that question, yeah, this is the season. They go from thunders up to first frost, usually September, something like that. That's the season of fasting. Did I answer that question?
Yes, I think so.
Okay.
And we have another one from Françoise Le Goff, who's in France, I believe, or maybe she's in South Africa. I can't remember. She moves around. Thank you for sharing your experience of Indigenous fasting. Do you feel that since you became a Baha'i and understand the Baha'i laws, that your fast today has a deeper meaning for you, and do you feel a coherence or a difference with your Indigenous communities fasting?
I have to say this, I have to admit this, that I love fasting. I love the Baha'i fast so much. It's not practical, but sometimes I just wish you could do it all the time. But still, I really enjoy going out on the traditional style fasting, and I'm really thankful I have the strength to do that. I'm only in my mid-60s now, so I can still do that. But it's just so uplifting. It's so uplifting and so empowering to do that. And it's just, and then just like in the Baha'i prayers and also in the traditional prayers as well, the songs, it talks about this really powerful, beautiful relationship that we can make through fasting to all the realms of God, physical and spiritual, and connect all these to bridge those so that there's really no separation, there's no delineation between them. And I think this is really the goal of, you know, these divine revelators is to blur that distinction that we make in our, you know, I guess in our material way of thinking and between this whole, this the secular and the sacred. But I think through fasting we connect all those. And I just love this law of fasting so much. So I like to just participate in it as much as possible.
Yeah. Very good. Louise Prophet LeBlanc, down up in Canada, says, Musi Cho, my friend. I apologize.
Yes, Musi Cho.
See you along this blessed trail. And she will be giving a web talk for the Wilmette Institute on September 17th. So we've got another 6 months before we will hear from Louise, who, of course, is a fascinating native storyteller and artist and member of the National Assembly of Canada, if not currently, certainly in the past. I don't remember the details right now. So it's nice to see her welcome to you. And then over on our Facebook page, I have to turn over here to see our Facebook page, we have various people saying thank you is inspiring and such. I thought there was a question. Let me see. I don't see any questions over here right now, but we've had a lot of people on our Facebook page tune in as well. Let me see if we've got any other questions here. I don't see any others just yet, but perhaps some will pop in. Mm-hmm. In a minute. That story you told about your 4 or 5 day fast that almost killed you, I guess you could say. It seems to me I heard you tell that story once where what, your uncle had to actually come up and kind of rescue you.
Yeah, that's right. When I got done fasting, then got two of my uncles here in Wakapala, Linus Endiphorn and Vernon Ironclad. And they're both doing really well still, by the way. And they came up, and then they just, it was like I said, over 110 each day. So I was just, that's really deplete you. Even though I felt like I was young, you know, well, I was young. When you're in your 20s, and you just feel like you're invincible, and you feel like you can just conquer anything, and you're immortal and everything, but then that just pounding every day, you know, just took me down to nothing. So, yeah, they did have to actually almost, you know, I couldn't get out of there by my own 2 feet, I don't think. But like I said, I just thought, well, you know, this life without purpose, without meaning, is just not worthwhile at all.
Ellen Davis asks an interesting question. Are there any songs from, you said, the Maid of Heaven, that are in English that non-native peoples can study?
I think there's some that are translated. You know, there's this book, I don't know, it's a really old book, it's a 1917 book, and this was given to me by Audrey Reynolds, and it's called Teton Sioux Music. And Audrey Reynolds and Jonathan, who, by the way, is still alive and lives in Douglas, Alaska, they, when Audrey was from UK, when she was young, she got this book, and it's still inscribed to her from Edward Blackmore. And when she read it, this is what really inspired her to, in 1963, to pioneer to Standing Rock, because this is a, in the field of ethnomusicology, this is a really a foundational document, because this ethnomusicologist named Frances Densmore, when she came out here, she had certain like goals, research goals in mind, but her informants here at Standing Rock, they didn't go along with her, what she wanted to do, and they actually told her that unless they could control the research, they would not participate. So the oldest people here at Standing Rock got together, and they totally took over her research, and
wow,
they put it in their own frame of reference, which it all starts with the account, the narrative of the coming of this Maid of Heaven and her songs. But I'm not really totally trying to undermine the question, but no, they're not in English. They're only in Lakota language, but they're in here, they are translated into English. So the first song that she brought, it's this one, and I could sing it, but anyway, the words, it says, Nia Ta'ia Mawani. She says, with a visible breath I walk, with a visible voice I walk, towards a nation I walk. And it says, she says, Waluta wa awa'u. In other words, towards a nation I walk, and then she says, something ancient, something holy, and something red I bring. It's all in one word, Waluta. It means all that. And this is the Lakota word, the best word you can say for the essence of the covenant, the essence of God's will. This is what she brought. And it was symbolized by that pipe. But it really sounds opaque. It really sounds cryptic, these words, in that when she says, with a visible breath I walk. What she's referring to is that, like out here in the prairies, everywhere in North America at this latitude, there's usually a sudden transition from the winter to the spring, and it's that time when this beautiful, I guess it would be a warm air mass comes over, and this is the warm air mass that all the songbirds ride upon, and it's the one that kind of ushers in the spring. So this is what she's referring to is not the physical manifestation of that, but the spiritual reality is like the coming of this refreshing heavenly breeze that awakens like the collective heart of humanity, which is like in winter in the grips of this ice and snow and all this darkness, and all that is released by this breath of, you know, God's breath coming over the world. And then, so this visible voice too is that word, that divine melody, that glad tidings, the summons to mankind to come into this this heavenly world. So that's what she's referring to. It sounds really mysterious and cryptic unless you analyze it like that. So anyway, I just wanted to show this book here. It has that, it's all about, they took over, the elders just took over her research, and they based everything upon the spiritual foundation of the Lakota, and it's a big, huge book. I think she collected like 600 songs, and those
wow.
are all, they were all transcribed on wax cylinders back around 1911 when she came.
Wow! So you hear them? You could actually hear people singing them on the wax cylinder recordings if you've got.
Yeah,
them.
Yeah. It was put wow. onto. It's available now on it's all been digitally remastered now.
Of course, good.
Yeah. So you can actually hear the original singers, you know, from 100 and, 110 years ago or so, yeah.
Fantastic.
105 years ago.
We have another very good question from Christine in Rhode Island. Thank you very much for Kevin, for your spiritually uplifting presentation. Please be assured that I and many Baha'is have been praying for the water protectors, including especially on the morning of the 1st of March. How can we Baha'is support the Lakota in their struggle for their basic human rights?
Yes, I think that you know, it's all the main support, I think, is it's this movement, and which, by the way, started out here in Waqpala when a year ago, a group of the youth who became aware of this this approaching pipeline decided to do a series of activities to create awareness, and so the initial activity was to do a run from right here in Waqpala over to Mobridge across the river, and that they started it and ended it with prayers, and that was like the initial activity. And I think what happened from there was that an accelerated awakening of the people who had become really negligent and forgetful and really had gone into a extended, like, I would say maybe like a comatose or a hibernation, about, especially with regard to these traditional role that's placed on the people to have this duty, this stewardship with the creation. And so people began to awaken to that. And so this huge movement just exploded here at Standing Rock, which was heard all over the world and received support and solidarity. And I think it just totally transcended the whole issue of the Missouri River, although those of us who live and grew up along the Missouri were really so tied into it, you know, just ancestor that goes back, you know, millennia, you know, there are ties to the river. It's just like the lifeline. It's the oasis. It's really the life vein that flows throughout this region that, you know, everybody attributes their origin and their well-being and livelihood and everything to that river. It's so important. But I think globally this transcends that. It just took on all sorts of meaning about, you know, the voice of indigenous people, the overdependence on fossil fuels, need to become aware of climate change, and all of these things, you know, like indigenous rights and all of these things, which just became a flashpoint. And I think, to answer your question, it's a movement that really, it didn't really start here, but it just took on an added facet of significance here, and it's just growing. And again, going back to the March 1st, statement, we can see so much guidance about exactly how to channel this impulse and how to relate it to ourselves as individuals and what we can achieve in this. Because, you know, the fast is a time when we can really initiate changes in our personal lives, in our personal character that have not just personal effect, but just reverberate out through our families and communities. And so I think that this is really such a beautiful question as to what we can do within our own personal lives and environment to just ramp this all up about this, the awareness, our relationship as spiritual beings to each other and to the world.
We have another question here, which is perhaps a little bit tangential, though not much. Paul wants to know what you think of the book Black Elk Speaks.
Yeah, Black Elk Speaks. You know, this was a man. His name was Black Elk, and it was you know, he had the book is noted on a number of perspectives. One of them is that it's one of the most detailed accounts, bar none, of what you would call a near-death experience. In this case, Black Elk went into a coma for 9 days, and he went out into the heavenly worlds beyond, and he saw this whole divine drama, this theophany unfolding. And of course, you know, this is right during this period of intense revelation of Baha'u'llah. And you can see how, if you, from a Baha'i perspective, you look at Black Elk Speaks, you can see how it just perfectly matches up, and how you know, Black Elk, he saw all this divine drama unfolding about, you know, how mankind was making this journey up this mountain, and that you know, when he stood in this, it's symbolic, you know, the mankind achieving this scaling this mountain of divine knowledge. And then, you know, remember at the top, where I can't even remember the quote verbatim, but he saw that the hoop of his people was but one of many hoops of all humankind. So like all the different nations, of all the different kindreds of humanity, they formed one great circle made of many circles. And so then this man, Black Elk, you know, he lived his life, went through all this tragedy, all this, he was at the tail end of all this, the Holocaust, really, that visited North America, and that all played out, and he was an eyewitness to all of that. And then as a living in the reservation life, he felt really helpless, and he felt so that he had failed his high calling. And that when he, this man named John Neihardt, he was the poet laureate of Nebraska, not then, but afterwards he became poet laureate, but from Nebraska, he came upon Black Elk because, you know, the John Neihardt was doing research on the ghost dance, which, by the way, was the millennial movement. You know, this man named Mavoka, he was taken to heaven. He saw the old world order rolling up, and he saw that the people had to cleanse and purify themselves and prepare themselves for the advent of this day of God. But anyway, he was researching that, and he came upon, they told him, well, everybody told him, well, you have to see Black Elk. And he was in a little tent, down in Nebraska picking potatoes, and he came upon him. And so then the following spring, when Neihardt went to visit Black Elk, and he interviewed Black Elk, and of course Black Elk didn't speak English, but his son Ben did. Ben spoke English, and a lot of us, like my generation, we all remember Ben Black Elk quite well. He was a very nice man. And then Neihardt's daughter was a stenographer, so she took shorthand, and then Ben would translate from his dad, then she would write it all shorthand. So that's how they compiled Black Elk Speaks. And then, as you know, when it was published, I think in the 20s or something, it was unsuccessful. It didn't go anywhere. And then finally, in the 60s, and they reprinted it, and all the hippies got a hold of it, and it just went ballistic, and they translated it into like 20 languages. But basically, they just think of it as this epitaph for a dying people. But in reality, it's this incredible document of this man who saw this great process of regeneration and renewal going on in the world. And at the end, where he prays. If you look at that, it's in the prologue. He says that how impotent he felt, but his prayer was that this tree of life, which seemed to have been effaced and cut down. He was praying that that a remnant of this tree of life could be found and nurtured and could grow and could the branches could reach out over humanity and could be filled with flowers and singing birds and fruit and could shelter all humanity. And so this is his prayer at the very end. You look at it. And so this is what he, in a way, he was enjoining and adjuring the people to find that remnant, that it's the covenant, really. He's talking about the covenant, and that the people could join him in nurturing that and enabling that to grow. And of course, we all know what that is. And really, that is what the whole book is about, if you really look at it. So that's my take. So
a Black Elk. I will have to read it with new eyes. I've read bits of
it. Yeah, look at it. It's really amazing. You know, it's not only in 20 languages. It's a classic. You know, everywhere you go anywhere in Germany or Japan or whatever, and people read that book. It's really a classic.
It is. It's become really very, very widespread and very much referred to.
And read it. It only takes like 3 or 4 hours to read. It's just fascinating. Yeah. Read, yeah.
Maybe we should put things back to my computer real quick, because I think that's it. We don't have any other questions.
Okay.
To change the presenter to my thing real quick, just to let people know about, let me get rid of this, remind people of our next upcoming set of talks here. Well, these are our courses, I'm sorry. We have a bunch of courses coming up. The healthcare and social action one is for primarily for healthcare professionals to talk about what they can do with their professions to serve the public. The D-Calendar, of course, is about the Baha'i calendar. The arts course reviews the Baha'i guidance about the Baha'i compilation of Baha'i writings and also writings by Baha'i artists about the relationship between the Baha'i faith and the arts. Kevin, you would have something to say about that, too.
Yeah.
We have an economics course coming up, marriage course, and, of course, Native American religion spirituality is coming up on April 1st, and this particular video will be one of the videos in that course. Kevin's going to do several videos for that course, and we're going to put some of them up this way as a live presentation for people so that they can get at least a taste of that course. I think that wraps it up. Thank you again, Kevin, for a really fantastic presentation. It was really very exciting, and a lot of people on the Facebook page thanked you profusely for making the presentation.
Yeah. Wish everybody all the best. Everybody all the best for this fast, and that with that and with the divine guidance we have, that we could just really, you know, derive so many blessings from this sacred time. Thank you.
Yep, exactly. And so, from the Wilmette Institute, we want to thank everybody. Keep your eye out for our next Deepen web video program. We don't have any scheduled yet, but I'm sure we'll be scheduling quite a few in the near future, and we'll, of course, publicize them quite widely. So thank you, everybody, and good luck with your fast today, and we look forward to seeing you again.